go. All right, so let's go ahead and do a quick review of the topics that we have already gone over, just so that you have a refresh of, you know, all the different projects or different sample programs that we have worked on, so you can incorporate, you know, some of those in your project. All right, and the best place to look at those things would be the shared drive, because, you know, with every single sample program, I have a zip file corresponding to that. All right, so we talked about a few things. We talked about the action bar. So the action bar discussion has to do with basically menuing. You know, how do you set up menus with an action bar? So that's kind of useful, okay? Because a lot of apps, you know, have used the action bar to set up menus and whatnot. I personally really have some doubts on, you know, whether a action bar has a lot of values in mobile apps. What do you guys think?
I think it depends on the app.
Okay.
I mean, for a game, it more gets in the way, but for utilities and stuff, it could be a help.
I think it's just, you know, what people expect more than anything else, you know, because most people come from a desktop, you know, kind of experience, and they know, okay, we have menus, and that's how we get to various, you know, items, so they kind of expect the same thing. But you can easily just do it with your custom activities, okay? Just have your activities to talk to, deal with multiple different type of settings instead of using a menu. You know, there's no reason why you cannot do that.
Well, the only advantage, I guess, to the menu is it kind of overlays whatever activity you're in, right?
Right.
So, I mean, if you wanted to build something custom, then you'd have to save your state and then push it and then pop it.
That's correct. But the action bar also constantly takes up space in your activity. So, you know, so there's that. Now, a lot of activities can take up the entire screen. So you just need to find a way to activate the action bar again, like a Kindle app. A Kindle app uses the entire screen most of the time. But when you press the center part of the Kindle's activity, then it will pop up the menu so you can actually start to do something else. So you can, you know, you can turn your activity into full screen mode, you know, unless, you know, and then you wait for the activity in the center, and then you just, you know, pop up the action bar. So we talked about that. We talked about cameras, okay? So that was kind of a long discussion too, because in order to use a camera, you have to understand, you know, surface view and, you know, all the various components of a surface view. DB1 talks about SQLite, okay? SQLite is the built-in database using a single file on any Android system. Do you guys remember that when we talked about the database? Okay, so the sample program that we talked about in DB1 just kind of emulates, you know, what we were doing in CISP 362 with TinyDB. So TinyDB is kind of a remake of DB1. Sorry, DB1 is a remake of TinyDB as a component in App Inventor. But you can do more. You can do a lot more than that. We talked about non-MAV counter or MAV counter. This is actually a misnomer because this version actually does make use of MAV or model view adapter approach of looking at things. So this type of approach helps to isolate the view, which is the part that interacts with the end user, from the model, which is the underlying representation of the logic and data structure of whatever you're dealing with. So we talked about that. We dealt with socket, okay? I think this, the socket program is particularly interesting to me because I'm more used to dealing with the back end of programs, and the socket program is one way for you to establish a connection to another computer, another server. So this gives you a lot of options because now you can connect to an HTTP server, just a web engine. But you can also connect to a MySQL database. You can connect to anything that makes use of TCP/IP. So that gives you a lot of options right there. This is a very recent program from Monday, because we talked about how to use a canvas so that you can draw stuff on your own. Okay. So for those of you who like to use the concept of sprites, there are no built-in sprites in Android. But you can implement your own sprites. Okay? So if you like the idea of a sprite, being able to program it to animate and go in a certain direction all by itself, you can do that, but a lot of people say do not do it because it is using extra memory for nothing.
What? Don't do what?
Do not do sprites.
Oh.
Because you can implement sprites on your own using your own class in a canvas, but it is using more memory resources than it needs to, because without the actual sprites, you can just do the animation and write a video game using a more using an approach that uses less resources, particularly RAM. Because the idea of using a sprite actually is takes up more resources. So here's the question: why do you think that in CISP 362 there is the idea of a sprite? Because sprites are not native to Android. Okay, it's kind of like an add-on feature.
For simplicity.
It's for the simplicity, and historically speaking, how did we start up with sprites? What is the first use of sprites in computer science?
Probably Doom.
Not Doom. Doom is like way, way, way after
Pong.
That.
Pong?
It's a little after Pong, because Pong did not rely on sprites.
Asteroids.
It's the Commodore the VIC-20 computer. They were the first computers with a co-processor on the side, so they offload some of the screen updates responsibilities to the co-processor, so the main processor can tell the co-processor and say, okay, this is a sprite, I want it to move from here to here on the screen at this velocity, and just offload it. Then the co-processor will update the video RAM to move that thing until it hits another object. Then the video processor will kind of go back to the computer, the main processor, and say, we have a sprite collision, do something about it. Okay, so this is back when the main processor has very limited processing power, and in order to make video games more animated and has better performance, they just offload some of the video processing to a sprite processor. So if I remember correctly,
Is the big fat graphics processor that we have. So
yeah, we can do 3D rendering. yep. And the implementation of a sprite is using the main processor, so it defeats the whole purpose of having sprites to begin with. So that's why most people say, do not use sprites, do not re-implement sprites in Android, because it's just not efficient. Okay. But the canvas is interesting because we talked about it last time, how you might be able to integrate something that's hand-drawn or drawn using your logic on top of the camera preview. So we talked about that a little bit last time. I'm not sure whether did you get any time to kind of test that?
I haven't got there yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
But they're both based on, they can be both be based on surface view, okay? And the test canvas program is also more complicated than it needs to be, because this one uses a background thread to update the images, which is kind of cool, because if you have a game, you probably want the game to be like refreshing the screen as fast as possible, but you don't want the user interface to get any lag because it's using the same thread as your main slash UI thread. So test canvas uses a separate thread to update the screen. If you're writing a game or anything that requires constant update, that may be something that you want to look into. Test FB is another one that is kind of complicated, long, and just kind of lengthy, because it's using Firebase. This one only deals with authentication and a very simple way of using a Firebase to maintain a counter. But it does illustrate all the steps that you need to go through in order to authenticate, make a connection to a Firebase, and utilize the Firebase as a database backend. Okay, so it has all the basic code that you need to do that. So you guys are more than welcome to borrow code from any one of these sample programs, because that's what it's for. Okay, is to illustrate at least one way of using a resource like that.
What kind of data can you store in the Firebase? I was wondering.
What kind of data?
Yeah.
Now, this is very interesting. I actually read up on that quite a bit. You can pass an object and say store the object in Firebase, and what the Firebase engine combined with the Android API would do is it will break down your object into its individual constituent objects, and it will create basically it will recreate the structure of the object. So if you look up Firebase Android and the API is what you want to look at. So create a reference, upload files, download files, use file metadata. Okay, we're not talking about navigate here. We want to talk. Let me see if I can find the full reference to database reference as a type. So basic write operations, it natively understands all the basic types, string, long, double, boolean, so those are pretty easy. Map is basically just a hash in Perl or an associative array in PHP. So it natively understands, you know, a map of string to whatever object. In other words, it creates the sub-items automatically. And also a list, which is basically just a linear list of objects. So it natively understands all that stuff. However, if you use a Java object, the content of your object are automatically mapped to child locations in a nested fashion. So that's the really cool part. That means, you know, if you have a user class, and I think it only works on public members. So if you have members that are not public, it won't be able to do it. But if it is public, it will automatically create the username and email subcomponents of this object. So you can use a set value. So in this case, you know, it's just using set. It's using set value on user, and user is a class, and it will automatically create the child components, one corresponding to username and one corresponding to email. I have not tested it, okay, but according to the documentation, that's what it will do automatically.
Scroll down just a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
5 lines or so. So it says user child
type. You need to have a default
string user ID. So okay, so they wrote user's username.
So that,
yes.
Okay. So that line that your cursor is almost on would actually go into the database and change a value in the object stored in the database.
This will store. Okay, you're referring to this line or this line?
No, the one that you have.
This line here? So this one will basically, it will start the process. Remember, set value returns right away. As soon as the request is sent, it will return right away. So this particular line, you know, the line that I have highlighted, will actually set up wherever the reference is, because mDatabase is a database reference. No, I take it back. So mDatabase is the actual Firebase database. Let me look it up. It doesn't make sense for it to be a database. It should be a reference. It doesn't say anything here. And it doesn't say anything about mDatabase. So I'm going to suspect that mDatabase is a database reference because you can refer to a child only if you're dealing with a database reference. So it will go to whatever point you have.
Oh, okay. All right.
Go to the user's node, right? And then under the user's node, it will create
user
a child user ID. So whatever ID it is, okay? So XYZ. So let's say XYZ is the user ID. And then what it will do is it will create the two children. One is called username, which is based on the name of the member of the class. And then the other one is going to be email. So it will automatically create the two members, username and email, whereas username has whatever string that is corresponding to username, the string itself, because we know that username from just a little bit above, you know, username has a type of string. And email is the same thing, so it is also a string here.
So did user ID already exist, or does it automatically create it when you set the value?
That is a good question. I think you have to assume that it is already there, because you know set value, I don't think it creates the path.
You create the value.
It only creates the value according to that node.
It's
It'd be really convenient if it created the path, because then we just do child set value.
Yep. There's a switch of make dir that can do that. That can recursively create every single node along the way to the target path that you want. Using set value this way overwrites the data at the specified location, but it doesn't say anything about creating the path along the way. So I'm suspecting you have to create a path before using this particular set value.
Because this one, in this case, would have created the path username on the next line, right?
Yes.
And so then they can set the value there.
Correct.
Okay.
So, however, you can still update the child without rewriting the entire object. If you want to allow users to update their profile, you can just update one of those. But for convenience, if you use an object inside the set value, then it will automatically locate all the public members and recursively deal with that until everything boils down to one of the elements.
So if I had a public map that had a list of objects, it would recursively go through those two?
Yes. And it can read it too.
And reassemble it.
Yes. But in order to be able to read and reassemble the whole thing, I think you have to supply whatever class you're dealing with must have a default constructor that does not take any parameters. That is the only requirement. Which is really cool.
Convenient.
It's very convenient, but it can also be abused a lot too. Because now a single set value that doesn't seem like a whole lot of operation can take a long time because you have a lot of stuff in a particular object.
It really just stores it in serialized JSON, right? So probably to some level, or
it is JSONable. Okay, it's JSONable in a way in the sense that it uses the same mechanism. So you have all of these children, and each one is identified by a key and a value, and the value can be one of the primary types or one of the elemental types, or it can be its own tree of nodes. And JSON can do that. The JSON notation can do all that stuff.
It sounds like that's the recursive strategy to this.
Correct. But how this is stored, I'm pretty sure that it's not stored as a JSON file, because that's not very efficient, for indexing. It's just that in terms of structure, anything you can do with a JSON structure, you can do it here, and vice versa. But in terms of actual implementation of how things are stored,
an object on a node, it can it holds onto the attributes.
That's all Google magic, Google black magic to be more exact. Because I'm pretty sure they have innovative ways of indexing, and also allocating storage on whatever backstory is behind the whole thing. Because this thing is set up to deal with big data.
Big, yeah.
Yeah, we are not talking about gigabytes. We are talking about more than gigabytes here. So, it's supposed to be able to deal with like huge,
terabytes?
Petabytes? I would say, they probably can deal with terabytes.
Petabytes?
I'm not sure about petabytes. You can try to look it up, Firebase storage limit or capacity, and see if anything pops up.
5 terabytes per file.
Terabyte?
Five terabytes. On that second link.
Where?
Upload them.
Oh, up to a maximum of 5 terabytes per file. Any MIME type, but this is the storage part of a Firebase, which is not the same as the real-time database part. So I need to refine this with real-time database capacity.
Pricing, I think, has the real-time.
Okay, real-time database. So the free account gets you 1 gigabyte, which is actually quite a lot if you're dealing with a toy type of app. And then after that, if you want to go for the flame version, I'm not sure I like, you know, the name of flame when I'm working on the project. So,
well, it's Firebase. So.
Firebase, that's right, yep.
Yes.
So, you can...
Flame and Blaze.
So DB stored is 2.5 gigabytes, and then this one is $5 per gigabyte per month. It doesn't say anything about the maximum capacity, which is what I'm trying to get to. Okay, let's read the fine prints. Okay, there's a limitation of 100,000 simultaneous connections per database on the Flame and Blaze plans. Okay, so even with the so-called unlimited, it is still actually limited to 100,000, which is not a whole lot. If you think about it, it's not a whole lot.
I know, with the, and that's in the Flame and the Blaze plan. That's
yes.
Both of them. Not the free one. Spark's going to be down there somewhere in the peanuts.
Sparks is up here because it just says 100.
100, yeah.
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 Yeah, but these are so-called unlimited, which is actually 100,000.
So it's not unlimited.
It's not quite as unlimited as you think it is. Yep. Spark plan only allows outbound network traffic request. So it doesn't say anything about the maximum size of your Firebase database.
Oh, Spark only allows outbound traffic. You can't build a server. You can't host with Spark.
With Spark?
Yeah, on the very bottom. Go down. And then right there it says in line...
The Spark plan only allows
outbound network
requests to Google-owned services.
Period.
Yeah. So as long as you're hosting it on a Google-owned service, like the Google Cloud or whatever.
Well, you couldn't receive a request from.
Yeah, you could. It just has to be the outbound request. Just has to be something Google owns. So like you couldn't use Amazon's web service, but you could use the Google Cloud.
Yep.
Infrastructure on.
On the Blaze
plan. Oh, it doesn't say that it doesn't allow inbound requests. It just says outbound requests too.
Yeah, the outbound requests can only go to Google-owned services. So you cannot go to Amazon, you cannot go to anything else with the Spark plan. So you cannot make something that's truly commercial and have the interconnectivity between your Google, your implementation using your Firebase project, and something else that Google does not own. So if you want cross-connectivity, you have to pay, basically. If you want to stay in the family and just use Google related, you know, services, then you're fine. But it doesn't say anything about the maximum capacity of a Firebase. This is Firebase storage, which is not the same thing as Firebase database. So I think, okay, this is storage limit, but it's not the real-time database either. Okay, this is storage, it's not the same thing. So it's kind of interesting why it is not database storage size limit. There we go. See if anyone figures it out. Nope, doesn't say anything about the size of the database itself.
Well, that would be the one gigabyte stored for above file storage, right?
That's only for the free version. But for the non-free version, it only says, you know, how much.
You pay as you go.
Yeah, you basically just pay your $5 per month per gigabyte. So if you're using 1 terabyte, then you'll be paying about $5,000 per month. Because it's $5 per gigabyte, and there are 1,000 gigabytes per terabyte. So you'll be paying like $1,000 per month if you have a Firebase database that has 1 terabyte of storage needed.
Plus the data exchange rates, plus the...
Yep. But when you do have that kind of size of a database, or you know, the time database, you probably have some kind of app that is selling really well.
Yeah, that's cheap.
That's cheap. Yep.
I mean, unless you're not storing your data very smartly at all, it's cheap.
Makes me think about, you know, how much it would cost to get the entire rainbow table.
Yes.
The rainbow table? Ooh, okay, this is MD5 rainbow. That should, I need it. So crack station, online password hash cracking, your MD5, SHA-1, and so on. Sorry?
Dictionaries?
Yep. It's a reverse hash. So if somebody gives you the MD5 hash of a password, you can look it up using the reverse hash table and find a particular string that can generate the same hash.
Not necessarily the password, just the same hash. How does the salt work then?
The salt works because it changes, you know, the whole thing. So you can look up MD5 and salt. It's an additional input to the one-way function. So it makes it less practical to create a rainbow table for every possible salt value.
Right, because it just multiplies the number of tables by salting it.
Right. So a salt is a random data that is used as an additional input to a one-way function that hashes a password or passphrase. Salts are closely related to the concept of nonce. The primary function of salts is to defend against dictionary attacks or against its hash equivalent, a pre-computer rainbow table attack. So it helps, okay? Salts are used to safeguard passwords in storage. Historically, a password was stored in plain text on a system, but over time, additional safeguards developed to protect a user's password against being read from the system. A salt is one of these methods. A new salt is randomly generated for each password. In a typical setting, the salt and password, or its version after key stretching, are concatenated and processed with a cryptographic hash function, and the resulting output is stored with the salt in the database. Hashing allows for later authentication without keeping, and therefore risking the plain text password in the event. Okay, well, let's find out, you know, how easy it is to crack it.
So it's added to the password before it's hashed.
That's what it seems like it's saying. So what we'll do is we'll do a SU and then a beer.
Yeah, I think what they did is they encode the password.
So this is a password.
Then they encode it with the hash, so that, or the salt, so that it does.
Never figured it out.
A part of this is the salt, and part of it is the actual hash.
And then it adds the salt, and then together that gets passed through the hash function.
Say that again?
So you have the password, and then before it goes into the hash, the salt is added. And then it goes into the hashing function.
Well, then if you tell everybody what the salt is, but I guess, it just seems like our passwords are inherently unsafe at, I don't know, 5 characters, 8 characters. And once we've done the first level hash, we now have a 32-character password that we can solve.
I would do a little experiment. I thought this Johnny. No, okay, what is the name of the Ripper?
Jack.
Okay, there you go. Okay. Yep, Jack the Ripper. It's a really cool utility program for those of you, and you can probably install it in a rooted, you know, Android system too. Okay, I'm just waiting for the whole thing to install, and then I can show you, you know, what Jack can do. So you can say Jack. Okay, you have no standard location set. That's not it. I think this Jack is for transcoding DVDs. But there's a program, if I remember correctly, it's either Joiny or something like that to crack passwords.
Mm-hmm.
But it uses a dictionary attack, a brute force approach, not a reverse lookup like a rainbow table. So it's a different mechanism.
Yeah, there's one on the web. I remember for, you know, how strong is your password or something, and then
Brutus. I don't know.
It doesn't really crack it though. It just calculates how strong it is.
Yeah, the most websites now have that built in. I've noticed they added that feature in.
Well, the length of your password is far more important than anything else. I mean, you could have a nice, easy, long phrase, and that's a way better password than J, Q, upside down, arrow, whatever. The space is so small. I mean, it's just, by the time you get to a huge 20-character space,
it's ASDF repeated 20 times.
Yes.
It's ASDF and then shift ASDF and then ASDF again and then 1, 2, 3, 4 and then shift 1, 2, 3, 4. Yep, exactly. It's easy to type. So that's a test Firebase, but this really kind of adds on to the value of being able to authenticate using a Google account, because if you set up your Google account to have two-factor, you know, sign in, that's automatic with whatever app you're using that is using Firebase to authenticate. So that's kind of cool. Does everybody understand what is two-factor authentication?
Yeah.
Yes, 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 okay.
Something you have and something you know.
Something that is from a different source.
Yeah.
So in addition to a password, there's another thing that you need in order to sign in.
Yeah, there's...
And that other thing usually updates, you know...
So two-factor, that's your account name and your password.
No.
That's where they text you.
Or you use
Google.
One of the Google Authenticator
yeah.
app.
Yeah.
That's one of the methods.
Well, the idea is behind it, something that you have and something that you know.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, you know your
password.
But you have the...
code that gets generated every 15 seconds.
But the other factor has to be changing, has to be morphing.
Not
these guys are cool because they exchange the algorithm that they're going to both be running.
Right. It's time synchronized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what they do, well, each one of those codes is a different algorithm.
Right.
So that's where they're actually morphing the algorithm, and that's what generates your code.
And then the other way is using, it's called a Yuba key.
Yuba.
Y-U-B-I, I believe.
Huh. Okay.
It works on a similar property. Basically, it's a physical item you have. You have to stick it into the USB port on your computer, and it acts as the second layer of authentication.
Something you know and something you have.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other one is something that you are, like your eye print or your fingerprint. You know, so there's...
Eventually, we'll have three-factor authentication.
Well, you need your fingerprint to unlock the phone, right? I mean, then you get to use the other means to sign in.
Yeah.
And of course, your phone is set up so that, you know, if you don't sign in and authenticate and say that, yes, I am Darren and I'm okay today, if you don't sign in for a day, it will self-destroy. It will install fake data. So it doesn't look
alternative data.
So it's not not the, you know, so it doesn't look like it has been wiped. It looks like it's legitimate, except it's all fake.
I think that would be a
really interesting app to write, you know, and I think it would sell like hotcake.
Yes.
I think they have fake phone calls. So when you go on a date, you program your phone to call you.
They actually have ones to deal with telemarketers too.
Okay, then we have a test sample program to deal with fragments. Okay, I'm not sure how many of you want to utilize fragments in your kind of project for this class, because fragments are particularly useful only when you're dealing with devices of different screen sizes. So if you have a particular app that you want to run on a tablet, which can be big, and also on the small, which is small, then you want to consider using fragments, because on a larger screen, you can combine multiple fragments into one single activity so that people don't have to keep switching between the screens, and it improves the usability of the app. Though on the smaller screen, you don't have an option. You just have to switch between the screens. So you have one fragment per activity on the small screen, but when you have a larger screen, you can have multiple fragments on one single activity. So that's the big value of using fragments instead of just activities. Any questions on that one? No? Okay. And then we have test sensors, which utilizes all of the sensors. Okay, you know, it actually serves two purposes. The first one is it talks about sensors, and the second one is it actually shows you how to use a list view. Okay, so it actually serves two purposes in one single sample program. And the way it accesses the sensors is it actually enumerates all the sensors that you have, and you get to pick which one you want to test, and it will show you how that sensor is updated. So it's really kind of interesting because, you know, when I wrote the program, I did not anticipate that I have that many different sensors on an actual Nexus 5 device, right? Because when I ran it on a simulator, it only had a few, okay? And then I ran exactly the same program on a real phone and go like, wow, that list just got a lot longer.
Yeah.
I bought a cheap Android phone for this class, and mine had 5 sensors.
You have 5 sensors? Well,
there was more sensors in the simulator.
And we can expect your future devices to have even more sensors because it's just getting less and less expensive. It will get to the point where you have one chip, okay, integrated, you know, with all the sensors. So it will be more expensive to have fewer sensors. Now, they might turn off certain ones, you know, in software, just so that people won't buy the $99 version and they'll go for the $150 version.
But then, yeah,
but it's all software.
Like us, you can turn it back on.
Yep, exactly.
How my Moto G4 actually has an FM radio built into it.
FM radio?
Yes. Some of the more expensive ones have TV, so.
Well, the TV thing is a carryover from the Asian market. Because, you know, over in Asia, everybody watches TV on their phones.
Yeah.
Because they spend so much time on the bus, you know, and outside of their apartments, you know, their cell phone becomes, you know, the main device for anything.
Yeah, so they use it for broadcast and select cast. Because when you use the internet, you select what you
exactly
want to receive.
Right.
Well, I mean, we totally disconnected from the broadcast stream.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, so they use broadcast.
Over the air TV they watch there?
Sorry?
Yeah.
It's over the air?
Yeah.
Regular.
Yeah.
Is it digital in Asia?
Yeah. It's regular digital.
It's interesting in.
We probably don't have the infrastructure here.
No, we don't. We do not. When I went to Hong Kong, like maybe 2 or 3 years ago, the 4G speed was comparable to my home Wi-Fi speed. It's not because it's slow here. Not because the 4G standard itself. It's because. It's the coverage, exactly. You know, how sparsely we have our cell towers.
Speaking of, we were talking about noise cancellation and how it hits the signals and then it goes this way.
Mm-hmm.
The electrical signals, they go right through each other, right? So it's really a question of how well you can receive and dial in, and then the stronger power over, you know, is louder than the other one. But they don't disperse. They go right through each other. That's why we have signals
yep
flying around without canceling each other.
Yep. But in Hong Kong, you would think, you know, with all the concrete buildings, you know, with the kind of density that you're dealing with, that we're dealing
yeah
with, you would have very weak, you know, 4G signals. But that's not the case.
No, they integrated it into the security cameras.
Yep, exactly. Because every single high rise has a cell tower on top. Almost every single one.
Yeah.
And that's
so,
more of a metropolitan net. Those
exactly
guys can stay together.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah.
So I can be in an elevator. And in here, you know, my wife, you know, works downtown, you know, in the high rise. And whenever she walks into an elevator, you know, there's nothing. Okay, 4G just completely cuts out. When I was in Hong Kong, you know, I can be in an elevator and I have 4 bar out of 4 signal as I go up from in an elevator going up.
Well, our elevators are made by Faraday.
It's just.
Was it he the one that built the radio cage?
Yeah,
he built the
Faraday
cage, which is based on the mesh concept. So the mesh, the size of the mesh has to be calculated based on the frequency that you want to block. So if you look up Faraday cage, you know, they'll give you all the equations. Like, you know.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
That has to do with the wave sign of the.
Yes, it has to do with the wavelength of the of whatever frequency you want to block.
Block lots of signals.
Correct.
Yeah, it's going to be like a mesh filter or something.
Yep. Yeah. A Faraday cage is a mesh.
As
far as I'm aware, the Pentagon itself is one of the largest Faraday cages we have.
They block the signal?
Oh, yeah. They block all incoming signals.
So, yeah.
Which makes sense. We don't want secrets getting in or out.
So, Faraday cage at the power plant. So the interference doesn't get out in this case.
Faraday
so it will lock in the interference signal. My wallet is actually a Faraday cage as well
RFID
to block
cage.
RFID. Yeah.
Yeah.
But when you look at the fabric or the leather, it looks just like normal. I can have my key card. This is my key card into these buildings. I can have it like this and do it like this, you know, with the key card. It won't work.
prove it.
Yeah, it won't work. It blocks it.
So what happens to the signal when it's trying to get out?
It just bounces off.
It's not bouncing off, you know, because the mesh itself is a conductor, so it's just inducing a current. It heats up the mesh.
Okay.
So the radio wave that is supposed to excite your RFID device is being blocked in the sense that it is only inducing current in the mesh and therefore heating up the mesh just a little bit.
Yeah, because your wallet's not grounded. I would have thought the cage had grounded it.
Nope. No, it's not based on a grounded approach. It's based on your electromagnetic wave is inducing current in the mesh. So the mesh is absorbing all the energy and converting all the electromagnetic energy into actual electrical current, so it doesn't get in past that point. And you don't need a solid piece of metal either, which doesn't actually block as well as a mesh.
No,
and so it turns the heat.
Yeah, it turns into heat. It takes that energy radiated from the RFID active device and just turn it into heat in the mesh. So if they crank it up, you know, they can burn my wallet. You just walk by an RFID station, goes like, smokes come out.
Oh, he must have one of the Samsung phones.
Okay, there's test timer, which is a test program to use a timer. So it is if I remember correctly, it is a program that just ticks with a time count.
And also it introduced toast or something when it was displaying it and you were...
I think that was a random message.
That was
a
random
that.
Message.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wasn't this one, which one was up about it as a service? We were backing out of it and it kept happening.
Random message.
On the
that was random message.
Random message.
Yeah. Random message also illustrates how to use a notification icon. So you can basically get rid of the activity itself, and then your app is only represented by a notification icon on the notification bar. And then when you slide down the notification icon, it gives you an entry, and when you click that entry, it will reactivate the activity. So, you know, it's basically, you know, you can do what most other apps can do now. I mean, you know, all the pieces are here, so it's only a question of what pieces do you want in your actual project, and how do you put all of these things together. And then we have the other one, which is two screens, which illustrates the use of intent. But in this case, you know, it is an intent to start up another activity of the same app. So it's actually pretty easy. You just have to specify the class that you need to, that is representing the activity that you want to start. But the power of intent is really quite a bit. In other words, you know, you can use intent to accomplish a lot of things in the Android system. So are there any questions about these sample programs that we have gone through up to this point of this class? Anything in particular that you want to do with your project? Your project proposal is due next Monday, but I do want to give you guys a chance here, you know, to kind of talk about it so that you can say, oh, okay, I want to do this. Is it doable, or how should we go about doing it? Yep.
Did we talk about putting like a part of a web page? Activity.
Okay, so we can explore that. I think that is really easy to do because there's a web view class.
Oh,
yeah.
You can
yeah.
Just drop the web.
Oh, okay.
So a web view is a subclass of view, which is a subclass of, so it's a subclass of absolute layout, view group, and so on. So it's a view that displays web pages. This class is a basis upon which you can roll your own web browser or simply display some content, online content within your activity. So I think it's a pretty easy way to do it.
Yeah.
It's just that you need to ask for internet permission, for one thing. And the sample code, okay, so rather than showing in a web view, okay, so this one uses a browser. So by default, the web view provides no browser-like widgets, does not enable JavaScript, and web page errors are ignored. If your goal is only to display some HTML as a part of your UI, this is probably fine. So I think I'm suspecting that's what you intended to do, is to show some content. Is it going to be interactive?
Right. Well, it might be a Michigan.
Okay.
But this won't do the inner. This won't do JavaScript.
It won't do JavaScript. Does not enable JavaScript.
Okay. It's just HTML.
Yep.
So let's say it's HTML5. Or...
Yeah.
Could I add Google Maps? Would they be able to actually use the maps and?
I'm suspecting not, because I think, okay, if you use Google Maps, that might be a different class to do that.
There is.
So you want
you'd
to
have
look
to look at the Google Maps API.
Android API. So I'm suspecting there's a different one to do it. So Google Maps Android API, so that's something that you might want to look into. So it includes, demo and sample code. So just going through this, let me just kind of look through this code, copy and put it into an editor so we can actually see it better like that.
Because ideally I would sort of like the user be able to actually track their, like those apps were running,
okay,
riding a bike, and it tracks.
So let's see what this one does, okay? Public class map paint extends activity implements on map ready callback. So it has, some callback functions already implemented here. OnCreate is the activity OnCreate, which is, the usual things. So these two lines we have seen, that's the usual stuff with OnCreate. It expands the layout. And then here we have a map fragment. And you have to use a get fragment manager, find fragment by ID. So it's a particular fragment. Sorry?
Implemented in a fragment for your activity.
Right. So the fragment is a part of the activity. And then we have on map ready. So this one probably has to do with on map ready callback. And it's latitude and longitude here. Set my location enabled, true, move camera.
So that'll be it'll open on Sydney, Australia or something.
Right.
That's the start.
Although I'm not sure what move
camera. You can pick the different views by the camera. That's cool.
But which camera are we talking about?
That's the lat long zooming camera.
So it's not the actual camera device, it is the quote unquote camera.
It's the view that
Google
you're
map.
Using to see the map
gotcha.
From.
Yeah, that's what
it's like setting your zoom.
So if you wanted to do like a street view or something, you would have a different camera view.
Yep, and then you can add markers to it.
That puts
okay.
a point on the map.
Okay. So that is kind of cool. So this may be something that you want to look into, is how to include a Google Map that is interactive and updating in as a fragment in your own app.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's another one, Hello Map. I can't display a whole lot because of the size of my browser. Okay, so again, just reading this part here. So it's a map pane, which is a class that is we are providing. It extends activity implements on map ready callback. So that part is the same. We
yeah,
also have a map fragment.
One. That's the same example you just went through.
Exactly
yeah.
the same.
Yeah, you saw change the map type, I think, down below. Just as you said down
okay.
below. Yeah,
I
there's
see.
All these different samples. There you go.
Yep. So this is the page that you want to kind of investigate.
Okay.
And we can talk about it too if you want to have a sample program, done like the whole thing. We can look into that.
Yeah, because this probably won't be too hard just to get the map, but to actually have the phone
mm-hmm.
tracking on there, I imagine that would be.
Well,
well,
the GPS.
It'll almost do that by itself.
Yeah.
Keeping the record of where you were.
That's part of the sensors.
That's your job. That becomes.
Yeah. Tracking your own location can be done without Google Maps because that's just part
GPS.
Of the sensors. The GPS, which is a part of the sensors.
Yeah, but you have to display that in a map for it to.
Right. If you want to display it using Google Maps, then you have to utilize the Maps API, the Google Map
you
API.
You might for your app, you might want to look at the Google Fit APIs as well. There's
they'll usually display
you
your location on the map. That's probably the easiest thing to do. Is just open up the map and display your location.
But then loop on it as you move. Is that they re-display? Is that the idea?
Yeah, so like you would just turn it on. This would be like for your fishing out on the lake, like you're out in a boat. So you just like turn on at the beginning, and then at the end of the day, you could just look at all your little swirly, like that one all over the lake.
You win.
Yeah. Okay. Like, so you would, you know, you just turn it on and have it in your pocket. And
so it's just a trail report.
Yeah, it's like all those like fitness things where you're riding your bike. Like I use one when I'm mountain biking or whatever, and you can see.
Yeah, so
tells you how
so,
far you went.
So now you just want to put that, now you want to put your breadcrumbs on a map.
How fast you went.
So it, these are the classes supplied by the Google API for Android. Google Map is a class. Map View is a class. Map Fragment is a class. So I'm suspecting Google Map is just an object representing Google Maps, but it doesn't do any type of display. It's the entry point of all methods related to the map. And then Map View is a map, is a view that displays a map with data obtained from the Google Maps service. So I'm suspecting this may be the way to do it. You know, if you need extra control elements and whatnot, you know, on your activity, this is a component of your activity that's just, you know, corresponding to Google Maps. Okay, a view that displays a map. When focused, it will capture key presses and touch gestures to move the map. So it is interactive. Users of this class must forward all lifecycle methods from the activity or fragment containing this view to the corresponding ones in this class. In particular, you must forward on the following methods. So that means, you know, you have to make sure that all of these are overridden in your own activity. And so when your activity receives an on-stop, you have to send it along to the map view. When you receive it on low memory, you have to forward it along to map view on low memory. So that's a requirement. A Google map must be acquired using get map async with on map ready callback as an interface. The map view automatically initializes the map system and the view. Okay, well, that's for a simpler method of displaying the map, use map fragment if you are looking to target earlier platforms. Okay, there we go. So there, it seems like, you know, everything is pretty much done for you, and the only part that this doesn't really tell you is how do you get the API integrated into your project? Because I don't think it is included, you know, automatically. It has to be added, just kind of like how we did the Firebase thing. Mm-hmm. So you have to add it into the project as a part of it.
Yeah, and he has to know how to draw a point based on the lat long. Because he's going to track the lat long from the GPS, I assume, right? Storing it away periodically. And then when he wants to display the breadcrumbs, he has to create that trail based on...
Based
on
the positions. That is probably in the Google Map class itself. Okay, so these are the... Because Google Map can do that already, right? Google Map can already keep track of a trail. The waypoints and whatnot, you can already track all of that stuff. Using a web browser, you can do that already, you can connect points.
Yeah, well, I'm saying it sounds like his app, when he's floating around on the lake,
right?
He wants to record his breadcrumbs.
Yeah.
Right? And then when he gets home, he wants to see what he did on the lake, and it should see, you know, I was here for ate lunch for a few minutes, and, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then, so he wants to plot those particular points.
Well, this is the...
And then share it with his friends so they know where to fish and where not to fish.
Yeah. Okay.
Caught nothing here.
Yeah. Waste of time.
Make sure you have all the good spots for yourself.
This is the Bermuda Triangle. Do not even come close. Okay, so here's Google Map, and this is the main class of the Google Maps Android API, and the entry point for all methods related to the map. Okay.
This is what we want to add something to the map, like a point or a marker or
add circle, add ground overlay, add marker, add polygon, add polyline, add tile
overlay. You're gonna be able to draw the trail.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you can do all kinds of stuff, but is it adding to the map? So when you scale the map, it scale all your polyline automatically.
Let's look at the poly options.
Because these are, okay, let's do this. Okay.
Oh, yeah,
Yeah.
So the point's in lat long.
Okay, yes, okay, so because you are using latitude and longitude to create the points, it is a part of the map. So it's not really just...
Your job's already done.
Huh?
His job's almost done now.
Yep.
Right. But with that recording, there's a way to get the lat long to wherever you are. That's you're saying that's the
that's a sensor. You can use a sensor for that.
So you do like an update every 5 seconds?
I think with the GPS, you know, it's the other way around. It's when the GPS thinks it's at a different location, and you can set a threshold.
I think there's two of them. You can decide you want a periodic update.
Right.
Right? And you can almost use it like a clock, where you can say, when it's moved this far.
At least this far, then
this far,
notify me so that I know what to do about it. Right.
Okay.
Which is probably the better way because it saves your battery juice.
Yeah, right. If you're sitting for lunch for 2 hours or whatever.
Yeah, it would just wake you up and then say, okay, then you'd have to measure the time between things and figure out how you want to represent
that. Yeah, it probably has a time stamp on that when it presses or something.
The system time is probably something that you can get to pretty easily.
Yeah, you would want to use the delta in time from how long you started. Because that'll be the most accurate, and then you can just base the
system
time
clock,
and you'll know whatever you want. Right?
Yep. So you can use a system, you know, as a class dot current time millis. So that's basically just a millisecond since epoch. So now, if you track your time, you know, when you get to a certain location, and the current time, if you do a subtraction, that will give you the amount of milliseconds in between. You divide it by 1,000, you get the number of seconds, and you know, divide it by 60, you get the minutes, and so on.
Thrown into the date routine, you know exactly when you were there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's pretty good, useful. That and the lat long are probably...
Yep. Yep.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, so it's pretty much, you know, it has a pretty rich API. I mean, this is like easier than the browser version of Google Maps. Because from the programmatic perspective, you know, it's already here. You just have to supply your own logic and say, I want to draw this line, you know, with these points.
That's it.
Yep. And then it scales, okay? If you want to if that particular map can be displayed with a tilted, you know, 3D fashion, your polygon gets tilted too. That would be like way cool.
It's great if it's a lake because then it's flat.
Yeah.
Yep.
It should be flat.
Yeah, so when you display, you know, tilted, you can actually see it in a much more 3D-ish way.
That'd be your lake.
Yep.
Great for fishing. That water's got to be the same elevation across, flat.
Curved, yes. Slightly curved.
Like if you're on the shore of a river or something, you know, you're moving up or down.
Yeah. Yeah, I know the Pokemon Go, you know, the video, the game, they actually get the data from Google Maps. One of my buddies, you know, he was in his Pokemon Go installation was kind of all wonky. So what he needed to do was to reset the cached data of Google Maps, and that fixed the problem in Pokemon Go. So Pokemon Go is actually just using Google Maps and adding, you know, additional stuff on top and call it a day.
Yeah, maybe one of those map types is no map at all. Then you can render anything you want behind it, and yet you're still in the real physical relative world.
So there you go. So I think you got, you know, you can get started with this part and see, you know, how far you can go with it. But I think Google Map, the class Google Map, is where you want to start. And then for displaying purposes, you can use a map view, you know, to display so that it's a component inside your entire activity. So you can add additional stuff, you know, like, you know, mark this spot with a fish, you know, or delete that mark.
Yeah.
Share with friend.
Privatize this fish.
Yeah.
Yep, that would be kind of cool. And then you can use Firebase DB in the back end to store all this data, because when you're adding the polygon to the map, it is completely local. You're not updating anything upstream. This is just, you know, completely something that you display, or the local representation of the map. But when you reset when you restart the app, it's going to be gone unless you have a way to remember that. And using Firebase, you know, a real-time database as a back end, you can now remember all these spots. So when you're fishing, you may not have, you know, 4G signal, but Firebase has the ability to go offline, and then when it comes online again, you can synchronize with the actual real-time database. So it has that advantage of, you know, because you might be out of 4G coverage when you're on the lake.
Yeah.
Yep. Awesome. So there you go.
Yeah.
Cool.
So they like to use better location reference pointing by cell phone towers. If he's out there on the lake, is his GPS still going to be accurate?
Yeah.
It won't be as accurate because you won't get the triangulation method of a 4G of a cell tower. But
it
you can still
is
use
it
the
as accurate
refined
as
method.
Like a standalone GPS?
Yeah, which is already pretty accurate.
Yeah.
We're down to 10 meters or something.
Yeah. And for fishing purposes, I think that's plenty.
What
is the
yeah.
accuracy?
It's not like fishing
in
the
same spot.
Military example, at
least one.
Oh,
10 military
wise. There's some additional digits at the end of the GPS signal, which I think are still. Did they declassify those? Or?
They might have declassified some of those.
The more refined those bit signals are, the more exact your position
is. I don't know, later you're going to get GPS.
Well, in the good old days, they actually artificially introduced jitter into the GPS receiver so that, you know, your location is moving, but that's artificial. Just so that, you know, civilian use cannot have the precision that the GPS is actually capable of.
At military bases, they also speak it too.
Yep.
They would drive along and the GPS would jump over if you next to a building. It's going to be all the way off the road. You drive, like,
interesting.
So I can't just
put
it on the top of my
into
drone
a lake.
And just fly it right in the window. But
yep.
Yeah, if you know how much by off, you can
that's
recalibrate
that's really
it.
Cool. So you got most of your fishing app thing done. Well, you have identified the main components. The main
yeah,
components.
Yeah.
We'll put it that way.
Well, that's just a part of it. But
yeah.
It seems like you have two things. You have the stage of recording.
Mm-hmm.
Which is one use of the app, and then you have the other one, which is, you know, display your view.
But I wonder whether
you download the offline maps, and you can actually navigate.
That's
it.
But that's what I'm wondering is whether it integrates with the downloaded, you know, the offline maps. Because if you can do that, that's really cool. Because now, you know, at a new location, if you know ahead of time this is where I'm gonna be, you can download and have it cached on the phone. So when you get there, you have no cell phone signal. You cannot download the map anymore, but it's already downloaded.
Yeah.
And then you can plot all your polygons and place all your markers and whatnot.
Yeah.
And then when you get online again, you can upload all of that stuff. You know, and it's going to be stored in your Firebase database.
Right now, I just because often you are offline out there, and so I pull up the map and I take like screenshots. Just
right.
And then go to my photos and be like, where am I?
Yeah, that would be cool. Yeah, to integrate that with an offline.
But
yeah.
If you just download the offline.
Yeah, so one additional thing you might want to look into is Firebase database offline access, enabling offline capabilities.
On Android.
Yep. So set persistence enabled to be true. Okay, that kind of makes sense. Scores reference, so this is specific to a particular thing. Keep synced true. The Firebase, okay, in addition, you can keep specific locations in sync. The Firebase real-time database client automatically downloads the data at these locations and keep it in sync even if the reference has no active listeners. So that's basically saying, you know, there are certain things that you want to keep fresh all the time. So if you go to a particular path, go to a particular child, and specify keep synced, that means, you know, even if you're not using that piece of data, it will still make sure that it is synchronized with the server. Because otherwise, if you don't access anything in the entire your real-time database, there's no local copy for you to work with. Because you're potentially talking about a 1 terabyte, you know, database, there's no way you can cache the entire database on your cell phone. So it will only cache whatever you have accessed recently. You know, that stuff will be on your phone, potentially, if you set it to be persistent. But if you need certain things, you know, and you say, okay, I'm not reading or writing it yet, but I still want it to be on the phone, you can click, you know, keep synced, and it will automatically keep a local copy of that. And all the children of that, recursively. By default, a 10 megabyte of previously synced data is cached. This should be enough for most applications. So your fishing application, that should be more than sufficient, unless you have unless you're storing pictures of, you know, the fish and, you know, whatever, you know, that takes up a lot more storage. But if you're just storing locations, you know, that should hardly use up any storage.
Okay, querying data offline. Stores data returned from a query for use when offline. For queries created while offline, the Firebase real-time database continues to work for previously loaded data. If the requested data hasn't loaded, the Firebase real-time database loads data from the local cache. When network connectivity is available again, the data loads will reflect the query. Okay, cool. Handling transactions offline. It doesn't look like there's a whole lot more code you have to deal with in order to make it work when you're offline. I think this part here is just managing presence, you know, whether a particular user is present or not, which is not related to, unless you want to track, you know, who is online, who's not, you know, this part does not even apply to your app. Cool. So anyone else, you know, want to kind of talk about your app and potentially what might be needed? Yep.
Do you want me to show off the Android CI I built?
Yep, go ahead. Yep.
Set off over here.
What are you building?
What's that?
What are you building?
If an app from an OS practice that will allow their clients to get like audio downloads, schedule attending like lectures.
And are you still doing?
So you have a back end and an end.
Right. That's the problem. Back end.
So are you still doing the crowdsource screen capture thing?
Well, I'm going to do the localized screen capture where I take the pictures and sync it up with the audio notes. And,
okay.
You know, if I put a social back end to it, it seems kind of piggy. And I like to watch my bandwidth more so. But it would be kind of neat if we could, you know, share it. But, no, this becomes more of an organization of classes, the class time, so that I can keep all the notes together.
Right.
And then more of a study aid than a social engagement aid.
It would be kind of cool if you can have a desktop app to access the same content, then you can print it out and manipulate using a larger screen and an actual regular computer. All right, I'll defer to Darren.
So this is a project I set up over the course of this semester. What it is basically, for those of you who use Git as a revision control, you can actually automate the builds of your Android application simply by pushing to a repo on GitLab. GitLab itself has what's called continuous integration and deployment. Essentially what it is it allows you to automate build of any application, desktop or mobile, using a Docker image. And where is my, there it is. So the pipeline actually pulls in from your repository hosted on GitLab. And so one of the cool features of this is that I actually just built one a few minutes ago. I can download the artifacts to, let's put it on the desktop. And that includes the most recent build of the APK. Why is there not a,
I don't have the GUI to extract that.
But yeah, inside here is the actual APK. And it's actually really simple to set up. This repo that I have on GitLab is actually public. And so anyone who wants to just fork it and replace all but this one file right here, this is where what actually makes it work. So the Docker image is the OpenJDK provided by Docker itself. It's built on top of Debian. I believe it's Debian SID. And then when you want to update which build tools you're using, you just change these three lines. And it goes through, it updates, make sure everything's up to date, and then it executes. And
this is all happening on GitLab.
It's all on their system.
Okay.
And the nice thing is Android Studio itself within plugins. Do we have Android Studio No, not. I'm going to show you guys how to add the plugin
on
for
the
it.
Command line.
Oh, it's on the command line. Okay.
Yeah. Just Android underscore studio bin 2 minutes. Studio.sh. There you go.
Have you done anything with Docker?
But Docker is, you know, it sounds like it's just an image.
It's an image, and then you change the image, and then you publish that one as an image, and
you
any
publish,
other mod you've done, you can publish that as a container.
Yeah, you can publish.
And so you build on top of, you know, you go find some base image that's most of the way, and you customize that image.
Is it kind of like a snapshot, or is it more of
it's
an
a snapshot.
ISO?
It's kind of like a VM snapshot
that gets auto-loaded in a more of a standardized container, and then Docker distributes those containers on the available resources, so they just keep imprinting more and more and more.
I see.
To solve your problem. It's really, I mean, I did some looking into it, but yeah, that's what, he's just, he took the base image of the Debian
I took the
unit,
Docker,
and then
made
mods to it.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
And then every time it gets called, it adds in my little modification.
It allows
GitLab
to build
the APK.
Okay.
Now the one caveat is there's two. These are basically debug builds. I haven't figured out how to actually tell it to generate the release builds, and they're also unsigned. So essentially what that means is that if you try to publish these to the Google Play Store, it's going to reject it. If you have a copy...
It's a public thing. You wouldn't want to sign it.
No. If you have a copy of your app already on, it's going to be signed with the default debug key of that and not your local one. And so it's going to say there's a conflict. So you would have to uninstall and then install the new copy from that one. Otherwise, it's going to say there's an error. But for the most part, it works. It's really nice if I need a quick snapshot of my APK and I say I don't have time to start a build. I can just push it and let it do it. To do it within Android Studio, just go to Plugins, Browse Repository, and type GitLab. And it's this one here called GitLab Projects. You just install it.
It's only got
4.9
stars.
I think updated about a month ago. 5 stars from and 56,000 downloads. You just restart it, and then you'll actually have to create a token so that it can access. It's kind of like two-step similar. It just wants to know, okay, that this app is authorized to push to
GitLab.
Let's restart.
Or that GitLab has authorized this app to publish
exactly. And then when you're within the app, also open Test Canvas, all you'd have to do is where it is. I cannot see it on here. Oops. So if you have version control turned on, you'd actually be able to push to, I don't see it on here, on your one.
The second line of VCS, you know, says, you know, enable.
Oh, there it is.
Yeah, there you go.
Let's go ahead and enable Git. Okay.
There it is. It supports CVS.
That button right there, it's obviously if you have the GitLab integration token pushed in, it will just push it up into GitLab servers.
So basically you just checks in the software.
It checks it in.
And then the continuous integration scripts fire.
It says, hey, there's a new version. Let me push this to the pipeline. It builds it. And about 10 minutes later, it's done. It's ready for download.
Download the APK.
Right back to your computer or directly to your phone. And I've been using this not only for this class, I've been using this for all my software recently. If you understand how to work with Docker, then you can build your own custom images. I have a few on my account, and it's just amazing software to work with. It's free, and it speeds up so many things.
This is a bunch of Linux images?
Yeah, they're all Linux images.
Can you click on what is Docker? Software container. Okay. What is a container?
It's the container is kind of like a
virtual machine, right?
It's like a snapshot of a virtual machine. It gets destroyed on when it's shut down.
But the difference about a container is that you can base a container on a container.
Exactly.
You just pick it up and mod it, and
exactly.
Then it becomes a new container.
So okay, so right there it explains, you know, unlike VMs, containers do not bundle a full operating system. Only libraries and settings required to make the software work are needed. This makes for efficient, lightweight, and self-contained. So it's kind of like a persistence when you supply the main distribution itself with the OS, you know, all the usual commands and needed tools, and then you install additional packages for specifically what you need. And it's only contained, so a Docker only contains the additional packages or whatever is.
So that's kind of what's going on.
So it's
both here and in my case, instead of having a persistent Docker image that would get out of date rather quickly and I'd have to rebuild it, I have it do it each time, which adds a little bit to each build, you know, about 4 or 5 minutes.
Yeah, you could actually stop that and check that one in. It's, you know, openjdk8-jdkdaren.
Yeah, I could actually build a custom
image. He'd have his new image published in the Docker community.
Exactly.
Which looks exactly like that image plus all of that.
Exactly.
Oh, so it's automatic.
Yeah. And that's your starting spot.
Exactly.
And so now they have these deployed operating systems that'll pick up a container and just start running it. So if you have your network code,
exactly,
and you're communicating through, you know, some sort of you explode. But their synonyms are like shipping containers. You know, you put your software into the shipping containers and they just.
So this is actually what happens when you commit from the command line. I'm actually just told it to rerun the job. Is it's first is a few minutes of pending, it pulls in the Docker image, and you can see in real time what's going on if you choose to, and it's just a.
This is running that script.
This is running right now, that GitLab -CI.
So it's pulling a Docker image right now.
Exactly.
So it's going to basically add the Docker image on top of some kind of base Debian Linux system virtual machine.
No, the Docker image actually already contains.
Well, it doesn't contain the operating system. It contains the core.
It contains the core file. So that OpenJDK is built on top of a Docker image, but it's a self-contained image.
But it's basically it's kind of like the Dockerite, from what I understand. It's like a version control system, and this is the Delta.
Right,
so
right.
It picks up the base and applies the Delta.
Yeah.
But what is expressed as the Delta? Is the Delta only the names of the packages, or does it also include the versions of the packages?
I think
those
when
versions.
you store these containers out in Docker land.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
I
think they're probably binary representations of that modified entity.
And this is the Docker store itself.
But it also includes the configuration. So if you are dealing with a web server, you know, and you want to customize the way you want to use Apache modules, those can be maintained as well as a part of the Docker.
Right, but you would want to maintain the web server, and then the last thing you do is customize it in your local.
Yeah.
You could
customize
it and store it up in a Docker image, I think.
You can.
You just wouldn't want to do that.
Right.
Right? I mean, unless that was its purpose.
Right.
Yeah.
On a fixed IP.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's installing some packages.
It's updating to make sure we're at the latest.
This is some of the really new CI/CD stuff that goes with Agile. So as soon as I check in my software, you know, this DevOps script start firing off, and I get a bug report submitted. You know, right after hit the return key. Where the stuff
error? It's just installing Android.
This is right now. It's just pulling. Yeah, it's starting to pull in the Android SDK. In fact, finished downloading it, and it's now extracting it. And
so do you have to modify the OS as well?
It's just laying it on top of the whole system. So the image itself is Debian plus OpenJDK. It's built right in. I pull in OpenJDK. It has that image of whatever it was built on top of, plus its own stuff.
Okay.
I've actually built a few of the images, so I kind of have an understanding about what's going on there. And it just basically just pulls it all in, makes a single image, and then when I'm ready to actually use it, it pulls it in from Docker Hub.
And deploys it on an operating system and configured and ready to go.
Yeah, I think it's using DigitalOcean for their stuff. So it actually, in their case, it's like a VM and then the Docker image and then my code on top actually getting compiled.
But the DevOps CI/CD stuff, that's just that's growing huge.
And this is all
what
free to use. All the tools I'm using here are free.
The computer science people that are, I guess the old IT admins, have all got together and decided that software developers shouldn't build their own software. And
pretty
so
much.
So what they do is anytime they build it in, they continuously integrate it. That's the CI, right? And the continuous deployment.
Okay.
That's the CD. So now anything that comes in, they just run it through their scripts as a bunch of fancy software people.
Yep.
And the image is now built. It's run through automated tests. Bug reports are automatically submitted.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so as soon as I check my software, I hope I do a good job.
Yeah.
Because it's already running.
Yeah.
And we don't have to build it. We used to have to do a lot of that.
Right.
You know?
As
soon as you check it in, they run it.
That's exactly what's happening here. I check it, my source code in. It, once the minute it hits their servers, it triggers.
You have automated tests on the back end?
I haven't wrote any tests for this particular one, just because I don't know how to write tests for Android yet. But this can do it. You just have to have a separate area.
If it fails tests, it won't update the deployment.
No, it'll fail at that stage. And that's the beautiful thing, is it will just keep going to the different stages until it fails. This is pretty much the main file. So this all stuff happened before. But this part right here is where things get really interesting. You can have as many of those as you want, and you just tell it what you want it to do, and tell it when you want it to do it. So if I wanted to actually have a cron job on my web server to trigger, instead of using any commits to trunk, then it can do that.
You can build it every night.
I could tell it to build every night at midnight if I wanted. If I commit, now here's the other thing, is it says trunk. If I have a branch called testing and I submit code to that, it will not build unless that name is here in this file. So if I want to have code that's not built, I just want to push it in, I push it to the test. I don't push it in the trunk. And I can have as many.
GitLab is more like make married to CVS or to code.
To revision control, yeah. It, that and then the script is essentially, when you're building software locally, if you use make, you would put make there and it would find it and it would just run it. As long as you have the tools installed, which you would either do in the Docker image itself, either build your own custom image or find one that has the tools you need, or you put it in the before script. That's how I do a lot of my testing, to see what tools I actually need. If I don't know all the tools, I put it into the before script, and then once I feel confident that those are all I need, I move it up into the Docker image. And then I just tell it to update when I need it to.
That's just Bash
shell. That's essentially just Bash script. It's a YAML file, which has some slight syntactical differences from Bash.
Oh, okay.
But right here, it's just running the same commands. I've not noticed any difference between Bash and YAML when it comes to actually running the script section.
Is YAML
an
environment?
No, it's a scripting language. It's kind of like XML and other ones like that.
Yet another markup language.
Travis is another one, but GitLab uses YAML for their configuration file.
Yeah, I can see how it's a lot cleaner than XML. That's probably why it's called YML.
Yeah.
Yeah, just a play of the
name. I'm waiting for
XML.
ZML.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
ZML.
Yes.
Just type anything you want, we'll go fix it.
Yeah.
anything.
So yeah, this is actually is public. Anyone can see this particular repo. And anyone who wants to make use of it, please feel free. If you notice any issues, like I have an issue right now Astounding because they just had the Android O update and I haven't changed the configuration yet for Android O. So I will build against those. So it's still building against Android Nougat at this time. But please feel free to fork the code, maintain it yourself, file issues against it if you see there's a problem, and yeah, just make use of it.
Do you have a document explaining?
Huh?
Do you have a document that explains the steps?
Yeah, actually, I do. It's on my website. Building Android apps using GitLab CI. I go into basically exactly what's going on. This is what I said at the beginning, the fact that it builds an unsigned debug build.
Did you load up your private key for us?
I haven't quite figured out how to do that yet.
You don't want to do that.
No, I've been looking
at
figuring out.
You can upload your public
out,
key, just don't upload your private.
Exactly.
Key.
I've been looking at how to get the signing key in there so it can actually build signed ones that I can deploy directly to
how
Google Play.
How long does the virtual machine stay up? So does it shut down?
Shuts down at once it either passes or fails or is canceled.
Right, right.
It shuts down immediately.
I'm just thinking about, if you have a successful build, you can have your virtual machine to contact one of your trusted computers and just say that, I'm done, okay? But don't shut down the virtual machine just yet. And then on your trusted machine, you can then open a connection to the build machine and then use that to sign your package. So you can have an exchange between the build server, which is not trusted, and your actual computer that is storing your key file. So it will send you the signed version, you sign it, and then send it back to the other server. So now you have a signed version on the other side. And
well,
you can do
well, in a sense, you can do that. You download the artifact, and then sign it locally, and then just push it.
Mm-hmm.
I think I've gotten close to figuring out
he's
how to get
to do
it
the CD part now. Continuous delivery.
Yes.
There's no man in the loop.
Right.
That's kind of where I'm going. Yeah, I'm trying to.
There's a developer, there are the end users, and the money in between.
I'm trying to figure out the third line where it says ?, and then fourth line, profits.
I think there are some dark uses of this entire
yes.
tool chain. I just need to spend a little bit of time to figure
that's
that out.
This is,
yeah.
This is what I'm doing to try and play with your Debian Live live build, is I'm using this to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I just am getting stuck on keyboard. I want to try to select.
Part,
yeah. That's why I need a pre-seed file for this. But yeah, this is one of my projects. As I get more tutorial projects up, I'm going to be pushing it to Cursive D Public, which is available at gitlab.com/cursiveD-public. And those are all going to be ones free to use. My Docker profile is also under Cursive D, so any of the images I build, though they're open to the public to use.
So does that mean if I send you printing, your daemon will turn it into cursive?
Yes.
Now, do they charge you based on nothing at all? So
they don't charge you anything for this. You
not
can be running
the, not when you do the publics.
Not even private. I can have as many private repos as I want.
GitHub,
no. And Bitbucket will do a handful of private repos, but they charge you for everything else.
Oh.
That's why I ended up switching to GitLab.
When you build the Debian Live distribution, there's a lot of bandwidth that it needs because it needs to download all the packages. And there's a lot of compute time as well because when it's building the ISO file, when it's compressing into the squeeze FS, that takes up a lot of juice in terms of processing power, and they don't charge you for that?
Nope. I ran, see, I can actually pull it up over here. I have the Debian Live image. So this is now, mind you, all these either were failed or canceled for one reason or another.
The CIA supports them.
But this is, I was 12 minutes, 14 minutes. They did not care. They don't charge anything for any of this. They do have a commercial version that you can, if you want to host on your own. But their commercial edition is actually what they use for GitLab.com. There's also a free community edition if you want to host your own GitLab instance. If you don't want to host it on their system, but I've not had a reason to just host it on my own. Their system, they.
So one quick question: why does the deviation between 13 minutes, 36 minutes, 15 minutes?
Keyboard selection. How quickly do I notice? Because I start these.
Oh, so yeah, it's human in loop.
It gets. I can show you what's going on. And the nice thing is that it will just is like all the way down here. So it's doing all that. It's pulling in things, installing them, and then I get to hear. This is why it gets stuck at different times. It's how quick do I notice it gets stuck there? Sometimes I walk away. Sometimes I'm busy playing Town of Salem, and. And then I look over and realize, oh, it got stuck. I still haven't figured it out. But yeah, this is copy of Tack's live image, the actual build.
Which is being used right now.
Yeah, which is being used right now to demo this. I'm just trying to figure out how to automate it, since most of the changes are just pulling in the updated packages.
Yep.
I figure if I can figure out how to do this, my eventual goal.
Public.
Huh?
That one's not public.
No, that one's not public because I'm still figuring out how to get it working.
It's just the interactive part that we want to turn into non-interactive. So it's
the only three spots.
Three spots,
and then we can have this thing public. And the nice thing is that when I do that, I'm going to be continuing to maintain this. So either you'll be able to fork it and do your own and let it build. Or you'll just be able, if you need a package to put in, you just create an issue against the project, and I'll take it and add it into the student file, and I can build one image per branch, have Tack's version, have Joe Schmo's version, you know. So
special,
it's
special dark version with all the dark
exactly.
tools.
Exactly.
For all the dark tools, yeah.
Yep.
AKA Lord Vader's version. So, and that's
which version of Linux has that? That's called.
What is the name of that? I was just talking about it yesterday too. The security focused, you know, version.
Kaylee, formerly Backtrack.
Yep. Yeah, Kaylee has packages that are not found in Debian, so you have to pull in some of the resources from elsewhere. And integrate it into the distribution. It's interesting. Kaylee has got some really fun stuff.
Yeah. So if you're already using Git for your revision control, I highly encourage creating an account. It doesn't cost you anything. And they have so many great resources. They're constantly doing webcasts, the guys behind this project. There's actually one, I think, next Monday that they're doing. And then they put them up on their website, talking about the various features that are on their project, how to use them. So they get a lot of, I also get some guest speakers to come on and talk, and that's all on their YouTube channel. I think it's just called GitLab.com on their YouTube. But
well,
it's a great resource.
Makes me wonder, you know, how they make money. I mean, you know, is it because they have a lot of corporate, you know, customers who are paying big bucks?
Oh yeah. They have quite a few. I mean, their commercial one is a couple thousand to run.
If you don't want to put your software, your trade secrets and your, you know, non-patentable algorithms inside the cloud, so anybody else could have them.
Yeah.
If you pick up their services and run it home inside your VPN.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, I see.
Yeah, so a corporation would want these exact services, but they don't want the freeness of it.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And the nice thing is that...
But if you're dealing with open source projects, you know, this is like
no-brainer. Yeah. If you're not trying to keep that private secret.
VLC I think that's how you get it on there. But VLC recently just started putting their stuff up there. And they're starting to use continuous integration on their end. So it's you know,
searching GitLab for VLC?
Yeah, it's searching for VLC right now. I might actually have to go to their website to get the actual one.
Well, he is doing a VLC search on at GitLab.
Yeah. It's searching searching for it.
I question how much resources they really have there. It's like three college kids with a couple of PDPAs.
Not even. It's
you can't really tell anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, it looks pretty slow if this is a search.
I think that's actually on this computer's part. Search usually is working a lot better. I know they said this morning their one of their search only databases, their read only databases was they're doing maintenance on. But yeah, they have. VLC itself has an account somewhere on here, and they've been using GitLab for it, the GitLab CI features.
With VLC?
Just search for A.
The video LAN player?
Just search for A for me. Just curious how many projects have A in it.
Well, I know I have quite a few. And the nice thing is Docker itself can actually build, if you have the tools in the image, build a Windows piece of software. So it's not limited to just, oh, let me build this for Linux or FreeBSD. You can actually build for Windows too. A project I'm working on for Matt Storr over in New Media, I build his software in my CI because I can't build it locally. I don't have the tools installed, but I can easily have them installed here.
Interesting.
That's nice.
And
they license that. It's a temporary Windows, right?
No, it's just Docker. It uses, I think it's like Wine and stuff.
Oh.
Certain build tools.
To build the Windows
software. Because you can use a Wing, you know, and other cross compiling libraries.
Let me see. Actually, I can pull up that project.
Yeah, you can cross. You can target Windows executable in Linux.
Okay.
Project.
Right. The actual execution of the code will require a Windows
CI
configuration or something like that. So Wine may work in most cases. The biggest problem is when you try to pull in Visual Studio stuff. You know, Visual C libraries, then you know it would take a lot of work to make it working.
Yeah. Okay, so that's actually in my
because
Docker
that's
image.
That's the most
incompatible
stuff. If it's just a plain old executable, it's easy.
Okay. Visual C is the most incompatible.
It because it wants to sucks in you have to know which version of the libraries it needs in order to make it run, and that's the issue.
So so the tools are actually built into my custom image of Ubuntu. I believe I built it off of 16.04. And that's the other, and Docker itself, you can have as many images as you want. They don't care either. That's the beautiful thing.
Oh, okay, Docker lets you have a whole bunch of...
I have right now only a handful. I'm building up my library because I have a lot of different projects. I like to have, certain things to certain images. Like I don't need Java when I'm making C programs. And then I also have my base images that have common tools. And then this is one of the beautiful things is I have my two build stages, one for Windows, and it will, when it builds, it actually has an artifact for that, and then also the one for Linux.
What's an artifact?
It's basically their way of saying an archive.
Okay.
And the nice thing is, in this case,
it's
the outputted by the CI. And the nice thing is, in this case, and so here's trigger. When I have it turned on my website, it'll trigger it to build this whole thing. The nice thing is, in this case, how it's set up, If build win fails, it will still do build Linux. I can actually tell it. There's a configuration that says if this one fails, don't go to this one.
Oh, okay. But as this is right now, it'll build both of them.
It'll build both of them because they're independent.
Okay.
The one building of this one doesn't depend on this one or vice versa. But the different projects are awesome. I mean, they now just recently added, not only can you have groups, but now in the case of my Android one that I have, projects, I can have sub-projects within it. So if I want to have, so all my public Android stuff, if I had like an actual piece of something that I wanted to release to Google Play, but I wanted to have it be open source, I could put it under here in this project and have it be its own grouping. So, and all this is free, it's all included. Unlike GitHub and Bitbucket that want to nickel and dime you for everything, these guys just don't. They don't care. They're like, if you want to give us money, cool. If not, that's cool too.
Processing resources, we don't have to pay for storage.
I remember when they used to break into your house just to get to your computer.
Yeah, these
now
days
they
don't
have
to
do
that
anymore
either.
No. The only limitation.
The trade-off. Free.
From GitLab itself that I've run into is the upper limit of storage for large files. It's just like, I think you can't generate archives bigger than 10 gigs. I mean, if your software is bigger than 10 gigs, you might have a problem.
Mine is artifact, not the
actual
not,
repo. No.
Yeah, not it's not the it's not the Docker.
No.
So Docker can exceed that.
Docker can exceed
yeah.
it, but files you can't have on the free version more than 10 gigs.
Okay.
And it cannot generate anything bigger than the 10 gig limit. But other than those, that one limitation, which I only hit once by accident when I was trying to build the one for store, I tried to include the videos in the repo, and that failed.
You're
miserably.
Trying to transcode a DVD, huh? Use a Docker to do the transcoding. You know, use GitLab. Require a transcoder.
Yep, yep.
There's lots of ways you could have used. Upload servers into it.
Oh yeah. Well, it actually does have the ability to host static websites. Let's see, I think it's cursive D.
I wonder if it'll kick them off after a certain amount of time or something.
This is being hosted on their system. I can actually also completely for free because I have my website. Well, okay, so the charge is on the website side, but I can actually map this to my domain if I so choose, and they don't care. They don't charge me for that. They don't charge for the static hosting. They don't care how many times I rebuild it. It's all included.
It's crazy.
Yeah. Definitely, if you're going to look into two technologies, look into GitLab and look into learning how to work with Docker. And you're programming.
A DevOps guy.
Yeah, I cannot tell you how many times GitLab has made my life easier in these last few months since
is
I signed up.
DevOps does? Is that
yeah.
What, okay.
They're programmers that make programmers' lives easier.
Yeah. This has made my life so much easier. Just taking the time to learn how to use GitLab's tools and learning how to use Docker. I've sped up my production time exponentially. I mean, I went from, let me see.
My builds don't seem to take very long. For me, all working by myself.
Well, the part of the reason my builds on here take long is because it's pulling in things from other sites, so it takes a little bandwidth. you're I'm gonna guess you're working all locally, and so it doesn't have repository graph, I think is where it was. So yeah, I started committing code for my project for this class on the 27th, and I finished. I got most of the way through my code within a month, doing the same things that I would have done locally. I ended up shaving a few months off my time, so I'm quite happy with a lot of their tools. There's so many more tools behind GitLab. It could really be a college hour doing this, just teaching all the different tools for GitLab itself, and Docker, you know. So
it might be something that we can introduce in CISP 300, because, you know, then people can use the tools chain in 360, 400, 430,
mm-hmm.
and so on.
Yeah.
Because you know it's the same tool chain. I mean, G++. And, you know,
exactly.
The test programs,
I mean,
the test files and whatnot, you know, you can automate the entire test process. So when students have to turn in their homework, you know, they can just fire up one of the Docker images and say, okay, here's my check-in, you know, let me know whether it meets all the requirements.
Fox would like that.
I think Fox
just
would
check
love
your
this.
Software into GitLab, and you'll get your grade emailed back to you when you hit return.
Exactly. Yeah.
Automatically posted in Kansas too.
Hell, I have on my phone, I have one of the apps that integrates with this. I get a notification every time my build either succeeds or fails. It's called Lab Code for GitLab. I mean, I'm using just a simple make, and you don't even have to have. If you're just using regular tools, their pre-included Docker image is fine.
Yeah, like GCC, make,
it has all those tools.
It does make but it doesn't address the issue of debugging. You know, because it tells you that your program doesn't work, fail some of the test cases.
Yeah, it can do the testing to a certain degree, but no more or less than if you were to do automated testing on a local computer or server, it can just do it itself. It can trigger that.
Right. He's saying, no, when you're ready to debug, you better get back home.
Oh yeah. Well, that's the nice thing is at the very least when it does fail, pipelines global build. Okay, that one was YAML. I just go from stages and I can look and see exactly if there had been a test included. Okay, here's one where in function it tells me the compiler output. If I had some tests going, it will tell me the output. So it's quite extensive in what it can do.
Because I'm thinking about a completely, you know, hostless, you know, solution for students to do their homework for programming classes. So this can do most of it, but not the debugging part. Because the debugging part still has to be interactive. You still have to be able to set breakpoints, go in, check the variables and whatnot. So in order for people to do their homework in 360, 400, 430, and so on, they still need
wouldn't
to
they
have
be
a platform
able to do,
that is
they
interactive.
Still can do the GDB and output the files, can't they? I think that's how the Fox has them do it. He just has them pre-write the script.
Right. But if you know that your program is not working correctly, you want to go in and debug your program, you might want to interact with the program live, you know, while it is still running, instead of just collecting the GDB output.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, which gives you a starting point, but it's not necessarily the best way to debug a program.
Definitely. But this is...
Yeah, by the time you check it in and see continuous integration, continuous deployment, it's supposed to work.
Yeah.
I mean, if not, your boss is going to be all over you. Your scorecard's going to go down. Your pay raise is going to be cut, especially if you can deploy it above. That would be the worst.
But I'm trying to use it for a different purpose. I'm trying to use it, you know, as a platform, so that, you know, when students have to turn in their homework, supposed to be using GCC, they don't need to install GCC. They can be using a very lightweight computer that has no development tools installed, and then all the development tools are installed, you know, remotely on the other side, and have it actually integrated in GitHub, GitLab, because, you know, your version control is there already.
You actually can with Docker itself. So if they know there's a problem, they just have to, I think it's Docker. Windows. There is a Docker, yeah, getting Docker with Docker for Windows. So the nice thing is that you can actually have the Linux image,
mm-hmm.
and using the same one in the CI as you do locally.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a way to interact directly with that image and have it have the code. So
okay, gotcha.
So that your idea will still work.
Okay.
So if they see in GitLab that there's a whole bunch of errors and they need to fix them, they just have to pull in Docker, and then it stores the image locally.
Right, you can run a Docker image on your PC, is what he's saying.
Yeah, you run the Docker image locally, and then...
As a virtual machine?
Yeah, it switches it to virtual mode, essentially. And...
another window, then? You see another window? Like,
yeah, you basically start it... should say exactly how that.
Okay, I get you. Let me
but
start there at the command line.
Yeah, you're in the command line. It'll pull in. And you can very easily copy files between the host and the guest.
Okay.
In fact, I found it easier to do than working with either VirtualBox or VMware to copy files.
No, it's not that easy to do.
No, it's
no,
literally like... I think the command is like Docker CP, and then you have to tell it which direction you want to go.
Well, with VBox, what I ended up doing was actually burning the files that I wanted to an image, and then loading the image into the CD-ROM of the virtual one.
Yes, yeah,
that's how I did it.
The other way I would actually push it up to the one of my Git hosts, and then pull it back down. I can just copy between hosts. I can do it back and forth.
I just map the SSH port so it becomes just an SCP command.
But this can do that.
Yeah, I use something called
And then the nice thing is...
some duck software. It's all transparent, working on the power server. I'm on my GUI.
Nice for what TAC's trying to do is with this. Even more so is because then you know, okay, if all the students are using this image,
mm-hmm.
you know exactly what tools... they have.
Mm-hmm.
You know exactly what image they're using. You know the OS. You know the tool chain.
When you want to run the Docker image locally, do you have to install their particular emulator or?
Yeah, you pull it. It has its own service.
Okay.
This is actually the output of the Docker on this particular machine.
Yeah.
So he's running it locally.
It's running locally as.
No containers. Nothing's running, but it gets down and describes the platform.
Exactly, and you can switch it to be interactive and run the tools.
But is it actually running the virtual machine locally, or is it just
it runs it local? It pulls in the image,
okay,
and then deploys it locally.
I see.
It does exactly what GitLab is doing, except instead of on their servers pulling from Docker, it pulls it to your computer.
Okay.
And
do you think it's QEMU based? I mean. There has to be some kind of emulation engine in the back.
I haven't figured out what it's based off of. I think it might be their own technology.
Yeah, I think that when you're pulling in the tools and stuff, you're pulling in an image that's running on their... Because they could do it. They could do this in client space, right?
Yeah, probably so.
You know, because you're only building a client application, so
right.
You don't need to go. And so, you know, as long as you've got whatever tools they have in that Linux tool chain.
Exactly.
They have the image ready to run on their running on this platform and they're golden.
And then Docker itself also has a way to automate builds. It's like
this is a convergence of technology.
Yeah.
It's a convergence of, you know, technology of revision control, web, virtual machines, build tools, and so on.
Yeah.
Because years ago, you know, individual pieces have existed for a long time. It's
someone's
just, you know, you have to type CVS, command line, CVS, check in, check out, you know.
And used to have somebody that would be able to build a multiplayer project. I mean, a lot of this stuff doesn't matter when we're all by ourselves, but as soon as we start working as a team.
Exactly.
I mean, it's a big problem.
Yeah, that's why I like building my project with the intent of allowing other people to join in, yeah. And this allows for that.
I don't even comment my code. I don't expect anybody to follow
I do.
I run it through an obfuscator before I save it. Even I don't need to know.
You don't need to know nothing. But yeah, this the combination of Docker and GitLab And then also Android Studio, I mean, with a single click, you know, obviously with the token, I can just push that and it will push it up and I don't have to do anything else. I've committed my code.
Mm-hmm.
I've told it to build. It handles the rest with just a single click.
Yeah.
And I would still compile locally.
Oh, yeah, you can still compile locally.
Well, if you need to test it and debug it locally, you're still compiling locally.
You're still
compiling
locally.
I mean, this is great when you're ready to share it now with me to alter my build configuration.
Exactly.
But before to do that, we want to make sure the group thing works properly.
Or even if you're pushing it to the quality assurance team or any other project where they're just testing it, they don't need access to your actual copy.
And it makes sure that all the software is always up to it.
Exactly.
On a slightly different, have you ever done any log file processing?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you look at big data, log files. The latest thing is everything happens in a log file. You just keep writing a new entry to the tail of a log file, and then rebuild whatever big data from snapshotting and rebuilding, processing the log file. Anybody can come in and process. Everybody's got the same time ordering. Somebody came along with this way of doing all these events. You just tack it to the tail of the log file.
I see.
Right, and then all that's keeping everything else in sync, right? Because we all know how to position, process, as many nodes as are available.
Yeah.
So you're looking. So you're mining the log file for specific things, or what are you doing to the log file?
Well, the log file is all the events, the entries, everything that's happening. You know, whether it's a database update, an entry creation, blah blah blah.
Right.
But then all these multiple computers are now accessing the same log file.
Right.
That way it keeps them in sync. We all know what order it is. I mean, if you think of the old queuing things, I mean, did you get the message? Is it out of order? Blah, 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 blah. Everything's now perfectly in order, and everybody can do their magic. And so I was doing some reading into that, and I thought you might be interested in it, too. Because, they're just making everything happen from the tail of the log file.
Yeah. And Firebase, the real-time database, can be used to maintain the same thing as a log.
It probably uses it by a log. I mean, when you think about what you write into the Firebase, it just puts another log entry what the user did. And then Firebase is eating that log to make sure everything stays consistent.
You can do transactions too. You can unroll stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Firebase, DB, can actually do transactions. So you can basically say, okay, let's start a transaction, do this. Oops, unroll. You can unroll the entire transaction.
Yeah, this is one of my images. It's in the public repo. There's also a way to do automated. That uses a combination of, you can either host the build file on the Docker file on Bitbucket or GitHub, and whenever you make a change to those repos, it pulls it in. Now to make it full circle, you can actually tell GitLab whenever there's an update to this project.
Post an update to that project.
Pull it, you can recursively.
Another feedback loop.
Yeah, you go. We found
start
another
two
one.
Projects for every one we finish. It's free.
It's free. Let's do it. So yeah, that's a fun feature. So if anyone needs,
they must have some sort of loop to text for that type of stuff.
It just pulls. I would think after a certain point, it might.
I mean, if you trigger a job and that triggers him and then he triggers me, so I trigger the two of you, so...
I've never experimented with that.
It's called a chain reaction.
Video of
you can make it look like an error, and that way they won't terminate your license.
Video of an iPhone, Google, whatever the little Google device is, and an Amazon. Stuck in an endless loop. One would say, hey, what's wrong with my appointment today? And the other one would say, oh, we have one appointment, and that is, hey, Siri, what's the weather? And then
I saw that. That was hilarious.
Oh, the IFTTT stuff?
So.
You've done that too, right? The if this, then that programming?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
IFTTT?
Nope.
Oh, type in IFTTT in the Google.
IFTTT.
That's big now.
IFTTT.
What is it?
T.
One more T.
IFTTT. That's a lot of T's, but yeah, I have TTT.
Oh, yes.
This is, remember turtle programming? Was it turtle?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's almost like that, but this is like if, you know, the light switch is done, or, you know, and the lights are blue, then turn the heater on.
I hate that type.
Yeah,
this,
I hate, yeah.
Sounds
but
no, like this is based on IoT, so, I mean, you're basically asking, you know, if the coffee maker's on, you know, or the light's on, the coffee maker's off, and it's after 6 in the morning, you know, fire the coffee maker.
That makes up for some really spaghetti code.
Oh, yeah. It's,
oh, God,
I, from the sounds of it, I don't like it already.
It was like Turtle, I think. Turtle Graphics or whatever that
yeah.
was.
Yeah.
Go up, forward, make a right.
And who's behind it? IFTTT.com.
Cricket.
Click.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, these are providers, so you can switch on their providers, so you can get the weather, and it's getting reminders, and your car can remind you.
And, so you can customize it, right?
Well, yeah, yeah. You write code in the IFTTT, and you or these things called applets.
Yeah.
You know, so then you've automated people's lives.
Well, we know what generation they come
which
from.
Is kind of like what this thing is doing, right? It's using... You know, if the code has been checked in, then I should build
so event
this.
Driven.
If
yeah.
this is correct,
the
then I should do that.
Yeah.
Event driven.
Yeah, it's event driven. The nice thing is it actually has is if you screwed up your YAML file, it actually can tell you, okay, here's the line exactly where it screwed up. You just run through their CI lint program on GitLab, and it will tell you, hey, this is the line that we don't like.
And you can always
and
go backwards because it's always under CI.
Exactly.
Feel free.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, cool.
Should I
thank you.
Off the recording?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Thank you, Darren.